Good morning. My name is Tom Jordan. I'm director of the Southern California Earthquake Center, which is a very large research consortium comprising more than 60 institutions, over 600 scientists who work together to understand earthquakes and in particular focus on the science of earthquakes. And today what we thought we would do is highlight for you some of the major scientific accomplishments that have been made since the Northridge earthquake in 1994, and also review how this science is being implemented and used to reduce seismic risk. Now, we all know that the seismic risk here in Southern California is very high because this is earthquake country. We do, in fact, have lots of active faults with historically, and in the future we'll have large earthquakes on them, so our hazard is very high. But as this risk equation shows up here, it's also because we have very high exposure. Over 20 million people in Southern California, very much a developed infrastructure that gets rattled by earthquakes. And so we seek to improve the fragility of that infrastructure, we seek to improve the resilience of our communities. And I think one of the remarkable achievements since the Northridge earthquake has been the collaborative efforts among scientists, engineers, emergency managers, and others that are dealing with the earthquake problem to focus on this issue of reducing risk. Now today what we're going to do is we're going to focus on the hazard part of this risk equation, where the earthquake science in some sense has its largest application. And so I'm going to review the science accomplishments over the last 20 years very briefly with some selected topics. And then my colleagues, Lucy Jones from the U.S. Geological Survey, Kate Long from California Office of Emergency Services, are going to talk about the development application of hazard products that draw from this science and provide society with the information it needs about earthquakes. And then Mark Benthian will briefly review some of the events and the resources that are being set up for the 20th anniversary next week on the 17th. So here is a list of accomplishments that we will be discussing. And I'm just going to start right off and kind of go through these fairly quickly. We do have some graphic material that illustrates these accomplishments. That is on a website that is available to you. And so you can get these graphics in their complete form. So I want to first of all talk about some of the basic data gathering aspects of the scientific program here in Southern California, in particular the expansion of the Southern California Seismic Network. This is the basic instrumental network that records earthquakes, detects earthquakes, locates them, tells us how big they are and what their properties are. In 1993, before the Northridge earthquake, this is what the network looked like. It had over 200 stations distributed through Southern California. But if you look on this map, you'll see there's two kinds of symbols. One is a little red dot, which represent the old-style seismic networks. And there are a few triangles, which represent high-performance seismic stations that record digitally and have can record over a much wider range of amplitudes. They can detect the very smallest earthquakes. They can record the largest earthquakes on scale. And of course, they can do that across a very wide range of seismic frequencies. So those new digital stations were just being installed in 1993. Here's the progress. This is the Southern California Seismic Network as it is today. And, of course, this network operated by the USGS and Caltech through the statewide network of the California Integrated Seismic Network is allowing us to detect earthquakes at with much higher precision than we have in the past. And to show that, here is a map where each of the black dots, which there are thousands of them, are earthquakes recorded from 1981 to 1993. And you can see on this map, Mark, do I have to enter?
There is up there, Tom, maybe under the mic, see?
Buried under the mic, yeah. Well, there's, oh, here we go. Right. So each of these black dots represents an earthquake, and you can see how they delineate active faults. Here are the earthquakes that have been recorded since 1994. And again, you see more or less the same faults lighting up in these earthquakes. Of course, we have the big cluster of earthquakes associated with the Northridge earthquake and its aftershocks. But one of the improvements has been the ability to relocate these earthquakes, get much more precise locations, and we apply those relocation procedures, we get this map. You can see, in fact, that the faults become much better delineated, much narrower lines. And if we were to focus in detail, we as scientists can use this information to much better understand exactly what the shape of the faults are, and how they are related to one another, and what types of earthquakes are occurring on those faults. So this leads us to the ability to improve our knowledge of where the faults are in Southern California, what their earthquake potential might be. This is an interesting issue because, as you probably know, the Northridge earthquake occurred on what's called a blind thrust fault. It's this yellow fault. What we're looking at here is a map of Southern California. Here's the state boundary. Here's the downtown LA, about where we are. And just to our north and a little bit west is the Northridge fault dipping underneath the San Fernando Valley. And that fault was not recognized prior to the 1994 earthquake. This set of faults that you see here is basically the fault map we had at about that time in 1994. It actually was employed in the 1996 National Seismic Hazard Map, but this model was developed largely before the Northridge earthquake. And of course, we knew there were many faults. Here is the Master Fault, the San Andreas Fault, many other faults in the throughout Southern California that are active faults. The question was, what is it we don't know about this system? And one of the interesting aspects are these blind thrusts. These are buried faults. They don't actually come to the surface. The Northridge earthquake occurred on one of them. These sort of reddish-pink surfaces show you the faults, what we're looking at. Imagine you've stripped off the surface of the Earth. We're looking at these ribbons represent the fault surfaces at depth. And sort of kind of looking down into the earth. And these pink ones represent ones that are blind thrust faults. And one of the major points of emphasis in scientific research after Northridge was to better understand these blind thrust faults. So what I'm going to show you is now the fault map that we have for today. And you can see that there are many more faults on that map, including many more colored in this red color, representing the blind thrusts. So if we go into look in detail, let's say near the Northridge area, so here's the coastline, here's LA Center, here's the Northridge fault, here are the blind thrust faults we knew before the Northridge earthquake, here's what we've learned since then, and you can see a much greater assortment of these blind thrust faults, including a major thrust system beneath Central Los Angeles that we call the Puente Hills Thrust. This is a fault system that is active. We don't we think it ruptures in large earthquakes with a recurrence interval of about 2,000 years. But if an earthquake were to occur in there, it could be as large as magnitude 7 or perhaps as large as 7.5 and would be extremely destructive. This is just another view of LA Center before and after. And there you can see the Puente Hills thrust system directly beneath our feet here in central Los Angeles. If we go out to the Ventura region, there has been also been a lot of progress in mapping faults. Here is the California coastline. This is the town of Ventura. We knew before 1994 that there were large thrust faults in this region and that there was a lot of active deformation. But recent work has shown that there is an extensive blind thrust system beneath Ventura, and these faults are sort of connected up well enough to where we believe that large earthquakes, perhaps greater than magnitude 7.5, perhaps as large as 7.8 or so, could occur on these faults. The last earthquake that we can recognize in the geologic record was about 800 years ago, and it caused an uplift of the coastline 5 to 10 meters. That was a really big earthquake. We, at SCEC, working with USGS and other collaborators, have designated this as one of our special fault study areas, and there's a lot of research being done right now through these programs to better understand this fault system. I'm going to just show you another view of these faults. This is the just a sort of animated view. This is the pre-1994 set, or the using the 1996 hazard map. We'll fade into the current fault set and then just take a tour. Coming in, here's downtown Los Angeles. Here's the Northridge fault in yellow, San Andreas in green. As we come in towards Los Angeles, you can see the big Puente Hills thrust system. We move out towards Ventura. You can see these major faults along the transverse ranges in west of Los Angeles, fly around it. You can see these are big blind thrust faults. They can't see them at the surface, but they have effects, deformation effects at the surface, and we can map them at depth using various types of information, including information from petroleum exploration and wells that are drilled for obtaining water and other resources. Now, knowing where the faults are is an important part of the story, but we also have to know how rapidly the earth is deforming that loads up these faults, causing earthquakes. And so the rate at which earthquakes occur in fault depends on the long-term slip rate on the fault. That's something that is difficult to measure directly. And one of the new tools that we have is the global positioning system and stations that record the satellite signals from the GPS system continuously and are able to get very precise locations of those satellite receivers. We can measure them within millimeters or less. At the time of the Northridge earthquake, there were three permanent GPS stations in Southern California. There are now over 250 stations, most of which are shown on this map, and at each one of these stations, we can measure how that location is moving relative to other locations. This particular set of arrows shows you the motion relative to some point out here on the stable part of North America, or the stable North American plate. And as you move to the west and to the south, you cross over the big faults. Here's the San Andreas Fault. There's other big faults in this area. And these vectors increase. And what that's showing you is the stretching, the deformation that's occurring to Earth's crust continuously as a function of time that is loading up those faults and will be released in earthquakes. And so we can use this for mapping the fault, helping to constrain the fault motions. And all of this leads us to being able to develop better earthquake forecasts. Lucy and Kate will talk a little bit more about this. I just want to point out that, in fact, what you have to do in order to get an earthquake rupture forecast, that is a forecast of how often, how big, and where the earthquakes might occur, is you have to integrate all this information together. You have to know the faults. You have to know the rate of motion. You have to know the earthquakes, something about the earthquakes that occur on them, to be able to get a map that tells you what is the probability of having earthquakes on these different faults in the future. So this is an example of an earthquake rupture forecast. This is one developed by the USGS, by SCEC, and the California Geological Survey, released in 2008, a so-called Uniform California Earthquake Rupture Forecast. This was really the first time we had a uniform time, what's called time-dependent earthquake rupture forecast. That is one that tells us not only how often the earthquakes occur, but what their current probabilities might be based upon how long it's been since the last earthquake. So for example, here in Southern California, this red zone represents the southern San Andreas Fault, whereas this blue zone up here is the northern San Andreas Fault. The blue indicates that the probability is a little bit less than average for an earthquake occurring on that in the next time period, whereas the red indicates it's a little bit higher. And the reason why it's a little bit higher here in Southern California is it's been longer since the last big earthquake. There has been an earthquake on the southern San Andreas Fault since 1857. Remember, the Northridge earthquake was not on the San Andreas Fault, it was on a subsidiary fault. And we are concerned, of course, about the big earthquakes that occur on the San Andreas itself. These models continue to be improved. This is the latest iterate, which is called USERF 3, or version 3 of the Uniform California Earthquake Rupture Forecast. And it was released last month and will be incorporated into the 2014 release of the National Seismic Hazard Map. So all of the science is being put into products that society can use. And perhaps the most important outcome is what we call probabilistic seismic hazard analysis, or PSHA. This is a technique for giving probabilities that any particular site, like right here in this room, will experience shaking at some level. What is the probability that the shaking that occurs here would be large enough to cause damage to this building? That's what PSHA tells us. And in 1993, this was the National Seismic Hazard Map that we were using. It's a little hard to read because it's black and white, and this is before we had inkjet printers, I suppose. But if you were to look here in Southern California, you would see that the hazard, you can see some drops in the hazard here, the lower hazard, we didn't have as good understanding of the faults in Southern California. That has, of course, improved, and you can see that in the 2008 National Seismic Hazard Map. We focus into California and the Nevada region. You can see, of course, these very red and brown colors, which indicate very high seismic hazard. What we would like to be able to do is to improve our understanding of how this hazard is distributed on a smaller geographic scale. And there's a lot of work being done towards that end that includes earthquake simulations done on very large high-performance computers, supercomputers. Here are examples of maps that we are currently using for the Los Angeles region, seismic hazard maps. Regions that are red have higher hazard, greens and blues are lower hazard. And what you can see, these are four different models that are used. There's a lot of uncertainty in these very detailed projections. And so, for example, we know that the basins amplify energy, that you can have larger shaking in basins than you can on the hard rock. But the question is, how much larger will that shaking be? And there are differences among these models as to the size of those basin effects. There are also differences you can see visibly in the near fault effects. We don't have much data that constrain how strong the shaking is right next to a big fault when it goes in a big earthquake. We just don't have many recordings of that sort. And so we have to estimate that from the limited information we have, and it's very uncertain. What we've been doing is using earthquake simulation to try to improve these detailed seismic hazard maps. And we now have models such as this one shown in the center, which are based entirely upon simulation. In fact, there are 200 million seismograms that go into the production of this map. Now, if we simulate over about half a million earthquakes at 200 and some odd sites in the Los Angeles region in order to generate these maps. To do this, we have to understand the details of the geologic structure beneath our feet, because whether we're standing on sediments, how thick those sediments are, what is the nature of the rock, what is the three-dimensional geometry of the rocks beneath our feet, governs how that seismic energy propagates and shakes various sites in this region. And so we have to have those three-dimensional models. And in fact, we have built up in the last 20 years some very detailed three-dimensional models that show, for example, this is our fence diagram cutting through the earth, and what you're looking at here is the LA Basin, a very deep sedimentary basin right here in central Los Angeles that shakes like a bowl of jelly. And having these models, we can better understand what that shaking is like. And just to illustrate to you one of these simulations, I'll show one that's now fairly famous because it was used in the 2008 Great Southern California Shakeout as the scenario earthquake. The scenario was that we would have an earthquake on the San Andreas Fault along this dotted line, starting here and near the Salton Sea and propagating to the northwest for almost 300 kilometers up into the central Mojave. That would be about a magnitude 7.8 earthquake. And when we look at that simulation, what we're looking at here, sped up in time, counter here is in seconds, but what you're seeing are the waves propagating up the fault and then around through these sedimentary basins into the Los Angeles region. You can see very high shaking in the LA region, And the shaking lasts a long time, several minutes, where you can get significant shaking. So that's the type of information that's coming out of these simulations. And as I pointed out, it was that simulation that helped support the Great Shakeout Earthquake Preparedness Drill in 2008. And this was a very important achievement because it used the best science that we had available at the time to estimate what a large earthquake would look like and what it might do. And it was a very large exercise that really demonstrated that we can improve our disaster plans by thinking through how a very big earthquake is, let's say, different from the magnitude 6.7 event that occurred in Northridge. We're pretty well prepared for a magnitude 6.7 event in Northridge, but there are new issues arise when you go to these much larger events, and perhaps Kate and Lucy will talk about some of it. The earthquake preparedness exercises, involving millions of Californians and people around the world, have really improved the conversation that we've had with the public on the nature of earthquake effects and what they can do to protect themselves. And we're very pleased to see that these procedures have been adopted by people across many states. These are states that now are involved in these shakeout exercises and countries around the world that are using this type of exercise to improve public understanding and public preparedness for earthquakes. So I will stop and turn over the floor to Lucy and Kate to talk about how this type of science is implemented and used.
I'm Lucy Jones. I'm a seismologist with the U.S. Geological Survey stationed at Caltech, so here in Southern California. And Kate Long is...
I'm an emergency manager, just a disclaimer, I'm not a scientist. But emergency managers are very straightforward people, and from federal to local, from government emergency managers to business emergency managers to the CEO of everybody's house, emergency managers have a very definite mission, which is we just need to protect lives, reduce injuries, and reduce loss of property. And the science really helps us do that. And in order for it to help us do that, it has to go from some of the complex things that the research that Dr. Jordan showed us does to really helping us have actionable products, decision-making products. And so Lucy and I are going to talk a little bit about that.
Right. So I work for the U.S. Geological Survey. So this is a federal agency that has the mission to develop and apply natural hazard science to protect the safety, security, and economic well-being of the nation with regard to natural disasters. One of the ways we do this is to partner with academics here through the Southern California Earthquake Center, which is, as you see, funded both by the National Science Foundation and the U.S. Geological Survey. We also have research scientists. I'm one of them. Many of us are working in the SCEC collaboration as well as providing the funding. And we have used, SCEC has become the mechanism by which we all study earthquakes here in Southern California. And those of us who live in Southern California don't always like to hear what an exciting natural laboratory Southern California is for the scientists, but that's the reality. And a role of the USGS is to go from that science excitement, the development that you've been hearing about, and connect with the emergency managers so that we get it used. So what Kate and I want to do is take those accomplishments that Tom just told you about, and we're going to tell you why you care. Okay? So I'm going to start with the expansion of the Southern California Seismic Network. As Tom showed, we went from having six digital stations to now approaching over, I think we're over 400 at this point. What does that mean? Well, it means we have fantastic data to do much better science. It also means we have much better tools for giving the emergency managers information at the time of an event. The big thing emergency managers want is situational awareness. How do you know what's going on? At the time of Northridge, that was a bit of a challenge. We had slow enough computers that when the ground started moving a lot, there was not just the main shock, there were a lot of aftershocks, that computer couldn't talk to us for over 2 hours because it was so busy recording the data. You have significantly more computing power in the smartphone in your pocket now than we had in all of the computers in the seismolab in 1994. We also had it that most everything that was recorded in the field was analog. So when the motions got really big, they clipped. We couldn't see what was going on because our system was overloaded by the data. It ended up taking us 45 minutes in Northridge to be able to say, you know, it's something like 6.5 somewhere in the West Valley. And we did that by calling up the people in Colorado who were able to see data from farther away and therefore not off scale. It's a big contrast with what we have now. In part because of Northridge, we got more funding. We also got the science excitement about how to put it together. So now, by contrast, you guys are probably all used to just going to the web to hear what happened, right? Figure out what happened. Well, where do you think that comes from? It comes from this network that Tom was telling you about, and we now are creating epicenter and magnitude information literally within seconds. We send them out through a variety of tools, but we're also telling you not just there was an earthquake located here, but what happened to you. And we do this through something called a shake map. Here's what it looks like for the Northridge earthquake. Very severe shaking around the epicenter and up to the northwest, because the fault started down here, but ruptured to the northwest. You can see here a lot of what you're going to hear in the stories you're going to be reporting on in the next couple of weeks. Pasadena had a very low level of shaking. There was almost no damage at all in Pasadena in 1994. 1971, Pasadena received a lot more shaking. You can see here the pocket of damage in Santa Monica because of that basins, you know, where we amplify shaking that you also heard from Tom. Okay, so these are now the sort of tools that we are creating within a matter of minutes. To create the equivalent of this map in 94, it took us 2 months that involved going out to the field and picking up the film. Remember Kodak, right? I don't know if anybody buys film anymore. We had to get film recordings, bring them in, develop them, digitize them, to be able to turn it into this map. This map now happens in a matter of about 2 to 3 minutes. It's one of a suite of products that we produce. We have the magnitude, the shaking. We have Did You Feel It, where through the web people tell us what they felt, and we can correlate it between what the instruments record and what people perceive. We also have tools now to do a rapid evaluation that tells you what the losses are likely to be from the event.
You can't imagine, as an emergency manager, how beneficial it is to have that shake map within a couple minutes. First, we have CISN display up. It's how we're notified via pager and via the website when the event has happened, what the size is. But within a few minutes, when we see that shake map, we have so much more access to initial situational awareness. Traditionally, how we found out after an earthquake where the damage was through something called windshield surveys. That's fire and police, who have a lot to do at the time, getting out in their cars and starting to physically report field damage. That's still very important, but the shake map lets us know almost instantaneously where the bad damage is, or at least the bad shaking, which is probably connected to damage. And that's super important because we know where to start to direct resources. We know, are we in the middle of a really big shaker, or are we on the edge of a smaller event? And also the shake map data leads to some other products which are very important. Shakecast, I wanted to mention, because it's very important. The example I want to use is Caltrans. Caltrans, once the shake map is generated, they take that data, they load it into information on their infrastructure in their servers, and within a few minutes, the field technicians are able to see a list of the bridges in their area, the ones that are modeled to expect the most damage, so they know where to prioritize looking at bridges to see if they're safe or not. That's huge because transportation corridors are very important to the response. And then the shake map also, that information leads us to HAZUS. And HAZUS is a FEMA product which we use to assess or to model deaths, injuries, economic impact, buildings damaged. And this is something that's very important for us for knowing the situation, but it's also, since this is a FEMA product, what FEMA uses to determine whether it's prudent to have an immediate federal disaster. And a federal disaster, as you know, unlocks a lot of federal programs which help us in the response and the recovery.
We also want to mention the other thing that this improvement of the network can do, and it's something that's just starting to get underway. There have been stories about it you've probably been hearing. That's the idea of earthquake early warning. Remember, we were seeing this potential earthquake on the San Andreas Fault. Imagine it starts down here. If you, you know, you look at the animations and all the simulations we've gotten from SCEC Science, it shows us that the it will be about 75 seconds from the time that the earthquake begins down near the San Andreas until the waves arrive up in the Los Angeles area. And so when we can use this information to be able to notify people farther away that the shaking is coming towards them. So it's the closest we're going to get to prediction. Right? There's no information in the earth about the time of a future earthquake. But once an earthquake has begun, we can send that information to you faster, at the speed of light, by through our electronic means, which is faster than the waves themselves will be traveling. So because of the improvements in the network that arose out of Northridge, we now have a prototype early warning system. We have not yet gone fully operational because we need to run it like an operation and we don't have the staff to be able to do it reliably at this point, but we have developed the science to be able to go forward, and the state has gotten interested.
Imagine what we can do with a few seconds to a minute of early warning. If you think of perhaps having something on your smartphone that helps you drop cover, hold on, so you're safe during shaking, but the automated processes, trains can be slowed down, chemical processes can be stopped, an eye surgeon can go like this instead of like this. There are so many uses to early warning that we were really just starting to look at how the private sector might be able to partner with us to do what they do in Japan, which is a complex system of helping change outcomes with even a few seconds of warning. So because of this, we have SB 135, and when the governor signed that into law in September, it's really an important step to us working towards implementation. We want to do it as a public-private partnership, and it's very important that standards are developed. So anybody who's working in the system is working on consistent standards so that what's coming into the system is consistent. And one of the challenges, of course, is identifying funding, because in lean budget times, as Lucy was saying, even our maintenance of the monitoring system we have now is done on a slim budget. So the state is looking to do some implementation planning under this bill. Going forward with SB 35, we are just now forming committees, one to work on the model. How will this public-private partnership be shaped? How will the system be managed among the many partners in the California Seismic Integrated Network, USGS, Cal OES, and the other stakeholders? What are those standards that will make the system work consistently? And a big piece of it is education and training. How are we going to provide the information to all our customers, from the public to infrastructure providers to emergency managers, so they understand what earthquake early warning is and isn't and how to use it? And it is not a substitute. It is a product in the continuum of all the monitoring and assessment products we use. It's not a magic bullet, but we will be able to make some significant public safety improvements through earthquake early warning.
And I want to make a point of how we continue to use the science through this process and a wide range of sciences. So actually, we are at the middle right now on this public, the education and training aspect of working with social scientists in risk communication to try and make it that we develop messages that are going to be the most effective in getting people to react to this. Okay, so the network things are all sort of obvious. I want to look at some of the other advances that have happened in SCEC and why they actually all matter to us. So we had the development of the community fault models. Tom showed you those great movies and what all those faults were doing. What does that really matter? Well, that is the result of a lot of researchers doing a lot of work in this area. And the fact that we develop an academic model is incredibly important. But that is not enough for people to then be able to make decisions around it. As we have seen in all of the interest in what's been going on with the Hollywood fault, the fact that we had developed these models about what was going on didn't result in changes in where the buildings were going to be built. What has to happen is that the California Geological Survey needs to take our information and turn it into a form that can be used by this model. And there was a press conference yesterday, the release of the maps in a couple of areas. So the new Hollywood fault map was released for preliminary evaluation yesterday. And these results, coming up with these zones where you need to do special building, is going to be the result of summing up through all of the work that's coming out of the Southern California Earthquake Center.
Since the beginning of the Alpha Priolo Act, there have been about 5,000 miles of fault mapped by the California Geological Survey. About 550 quadrangle maps have been produced. The two most recent, the Azusa map and the Hollywood map quadrangles, were released yesterday in draft form for public comment. Another thing that we get from the mapping, the hazard mapping that's important, is a public product. It's a CalEMA product, and it's My Hazards. And it's an all-hazards product, but this is, I've pulled up an earthquake page here, where you can type in your address, the address of where you live, work, or play, and find out what are the hazards near you. It'll show here, this is USC. We are subject to strong shaking, not liquefaction. And if we scroll down, if this was the actual web page, we'd actually see advice for individuals and families about what they can do to mitigate their hazards.
So looking at a few of the others, the GPS network, how to understand the deformation. That's another one that might seem a little more esoteric. It's an incredibly important piece when you respond to an earthquake. When Northridge happened, we were aware that the ground was moving up in some areas. So before the earthquake, you have a water pipe and a sewer pipe where the fluids flow in one direction. If you change the elevation of the ground, those fluids can start going in the other direction. Problem both with water and with sewer. And it's a thing that has shown up definitely before. To be able to come up with this information of where are things going up and down used to take us, again, weeks to months, getting surveyors out to actually measure the lines. Because of the development of the GPS network through SCEC, we can now get that information within minutes.
The information that Metropolitan Water District and the Department of Water and Power wanted about their lifelines in the valley took a week of really hard work to get right after Northridge. They can now do it within an hour.
So, putting these two together, the earthquake rupture forecast and the development of the probabilistic seismic hazard analysis, these are all the processes by which we understand where are the faults, where are they moving, summing up a lot of this work from SCEC, but then also including what will the shaking be so we can do a better job of saying what the hazard is. The final product, or a major product out of this, is something called the National Seismic Hazard Maps. They're produced by the U.S. Geological Survey for the country. Here in California, it is done in the partnership with the California Geological Survey and SCEC in creating that unified California earthquake rupture forecast and then turning it into other things. This is actually the map from 2006. We update them on a regular basis, as you heard from Tom. The next revision is actually probably going to be released in just about a month. So we'll be getting back to you then and what that will be is using the work from SCEC and summing it up to get a better picture of what's going on here. The simulation of the simulation-based ground motion predictions. Again, it might seem somewhat esoteric, but as you've heard, it became the basis for the shakeout scenario. And when we go and do these types of detailed work, when we've based it on the best possible science, we've gotten a lot more credibility. We then need to integrate it with results from engineers and social scientists to come up with the impacts of what they are for us. That's what we did through the shakeout process. It's something we will be continuing to do. There's a public aspect of it too, but it also is then used for emergency managers.
Cal OES and FEMA and local county governments have been working together on a catastrophic earthquake plan for Southern California. The scenarios are vital to that because the detail we have from the shakeout scenario makes it so much more possible to look at the cascading impacts from the earth science to the infrastructure to the economic impact, and that's what emergency managers need to plan for. So without the science, without the scenarios, when we exercise, we're just guessing.
And to end up here, we just want to make the point, this is sort of to reflect back on the partnership you're seeing, that the emergency managers, the federal government, the academics are working together in partnership. We're learning a lot more about the science, but we're making sure that it's used as well.
And that partnership extends to you, the media. The social scientists have told us that the number one trusted source after an earthquake for information is the media. So us translating, the science translating it to us translating it to you with the help of the social scientists is really taking it to the from end to end to serve our ultimate customers, which are our communities, which we want to get back to normal after an earthquake.
Thank you.
This part, I'm really just going to show you some resources that are available to you from this morning's meeting. So let me get it over there. So we have a webpage, scec.org/Northridge. It's in the handout, scec.org/Northridge. Just want to show you that all the animations that have been shown here, or images and animations that have been shown here today, are on this website. And we really, you may not have noticed, we really kind of phrase these as before and after, or at the time of Northridge and now. So they kind of are going in pairs, a lot of the graphics that you have available to you. You want to put this on a website, kind of show that difference in what we knew then and what we know now. So that's one resource, and there will be links to additional things, but also the animations are on here. You can see all the graphics and the movies that have been shown on the science side earlier today. We'll probably be adding some more graphics there so you can keep looking. The whole idea is for your stories going into next week. So this is a resource for you. Also, we will link to this to another site from this page, but earthquakecountry.org/Northridge is also a new resource being developed for the public for understanding, kind of in context, the 20th anniversary of this earthquake. And there are several resources that you may be interested in for your use as well. We have what we call ground-shaking stories, and these are so far 13, we're going to have more interviews with Northridge, people who experienced the Northridge earthquake, kind of tied to where they were, so you can understand the experience they felt there at the epicenter as well as further away. And these you can download, and also if you're interested in interviewing these people, we can put you in touch with them. So we have people talking about their experience right at the epicenter as well as further away, because as you know, as has been talked about here, the earthquake affected the valley very strongly, but was felt all over Southern California, so people had different experiences depending on where they were. We also have a series of movies that we're calling Northridge Near You, and these are movies that if the Northridge earthquake had occurred somewhere else in Southern California, meaning a 6.7 or so size earthquake, how would that be? This is a similar earthquake on the Hollywood Fault. It is a 6.5 earthquake on the Hollywood Fault. These are available for you to download as well to show what type of earthquake, how that would be felt. This is showing the fault network. We're zooming in on the Hollywood Fault there. And as we do, we're going to see that shake map of what the earthquake shaking would be in this particular earthquake on the Hollywood Fault. And then also it shows what the losses would be, what the injuries and fatalities, and then what the economic losses will be. So these are all on there on the website. And there's, like I said, 16 different locations around Southern California. You can see that the injuries come up, and then the actual economic losses. Estimated using FEMA's Hazards US or HAZUS software in order to understand
these impacts of these earthquakes. There also is an event calendar where you can see the events that are coming up. Here we are at this meeting this morning. But in next week, there are a number of events. They're at the City Council, LA City Council on Tuesday, in the North Valley and Granada Hills on Wednesday night. Dr. Jones is going to be speaking at both of those events. One is to the City Council, one is to a community event. These are all on here. And then next Thursday and Friday, there's a scientific conference, engineering conference at UCLA, and then a big event also up in Northridge in the morning, starting at 6 a.m., a commemoration, really more kind of honoring the victims and remembering what happened there, 6 to 8:30 in the morning. And there's also a event at CSUN all day on Friday. Next Friday is the actual anniversary date. So I just wanted to let you know about these two resources, SCEC.org, SCEC.org/Northridge, and EarthquakeCountry.org/Northridge, and all the resources that are available for you today.